Hi all, welcome to our next video. In this one, we're going to explore the idea of the real number line as the embodiment of continuity. And allows us to have a kind of a geometric foundation for continuity of real valued functions. Might be interesting. All right, so this is doing something interesting. We can view this as a mapping. The real number line is a mapping F from the points of L to the real numbers. If you say, can call it a postulate, like the continuum, I think it's called the continuum postulate. If you say that the line is a continuum of points and fills in all the gaps and there's nothing missing from it, then this F that maps points on the line to R is a continuous function mapping one continuum to another in orderly fashion so that neighborhoods are preserved and so on. We're going to move along with some construction work here and come back to the problem of constructing continuous functions between geometric objects. We have one continuous function already. We have the real number line. And that is continuous by acclimation, or we'll take that as a given. So here is the real number line, like this. Now, suppose I have another line over here. We have these two, L prime, and we'll call this line down here our real number line as L. This is quite interesting. So every point on this line, if you pulled the real number, this is a real number line, so you can sort of the line, you're drawing numbers in along at every point. But if you pull the numbers off the line, the point pi, okay? At that point, there is a decimal representation of the number, the irrational number pi. So that's a lot of numbers, see, stuck onto every point. Some of them are rational numbers, and so the decimal representation is either terminates or has a repeating decimal. You know, you can have like a number like 3.3333, repeating decimal 3. This is a rational number. So every one of these points, you know, if we have the real numbers down here in blue, it has this decimal representation. Now, a few words about the decimal representation of a real number. Notice this decimal expansion of pi. This can be written as a series. So in particular, pi, I'll write this out here, it's equal to 3 times 1 plus 1 times 10 to the minus 1 plus 4 times 10 to the minus 2, and so on. So all of the digits have to be one of the 10 digits of decimal numbers. So every real number is a string of digits, and they are multiplied by powers of 10. So look at this series here represented. This is an infinite series. It's the sum of all these digits times the appropriate power of 10. Now, when you're confronted with an infinite series in a math class, usually the teacher wants you to say, hey, have you proved it's convergent? What about this series here? I mean, just because we can write this out, how do we know we even have a convergent series? How come it doesn't diverge? Well, the ratio of terms is getting smaller by a factor of 10 in each successive term of the infinite series. 1/10 property causes convergence of the decimal series. And we can talk more about this, but this idea of attaching these numbers to geometric points is kind of impressive. I mean, you imagine having all these strings of digits hanging down from the real number, like some kind of infinite decorative ornaments for every point. It's quite a startling notion. What we're going to do is something that's a little easier than what Dedekind did. We're going to observe that we can create a correspondence by drawing a perpendicular to the line L. I'm going to clean this diagram up now. We'll just redo it down here. Okay, so we have these two geometric lines, L and L prime, and L is also a real number line, F mapping to R. Now, check this out. You can't stop me from constructing a perpendicular to the line L. Here you go. This perpendicular intersects L at a single point. P prime is a point on the line L prime. If I go down here, I have a point P where this perpendicular line that passes through P prime intersects the line L. So we've established a correspondence between P prime and P. This thing here is a projection map. We can call this phi. It's a map because you can repeat this process of constructing the perpendicular at every point on L. Furthermore, we have the real numbers that correspond to these things. So according to the real number line, there is a number XP and there's a number XQ corresponding to every P and Q on L. And because of this projection, we have the ability to take every P prime and Q prime on this line L prime and associate it with the numbers XP and XQ. So in this way, using the projection map, we have established a continuous mapping between L prime and the real numbers. Let's look at that as a diagram. We have the line L and the coordinate function that maps L to the real numbers. And the coordinate function F is bijective. So you have F, call it capital F, and you have F inverse. And we had a projection map that took it points in L prime to L. So we call that phi. And it's clear that if you have a point on L, the way we drew it, there exists an inverse function that gives you a corresponding point in L prime. So phi, the projection map, is invertible. Look what we have down here. If you have a point on L prime, you can map that to L. And then you can use F to map that one in turn to R. And this establishes a mapping F prime to L prime to R. And this diagram goes the other way. So if I have a number in R, I can find out the corresponding point in L and then use the inverse projection map to take that over to L prime. So F prime is invertible, and it is bijective, the way we've set it up. So we have the construction that's giving us a correspondence between the points of L prime and R. And furthermore, since L, this mapping L to R, the mapping F, is continuous, this correspondence establishes F prime as a continuous map between L prime and R. Now, the geometric version of continuity, that Euclidean notion of continuity, let's say, is being made use of identifying points in L prime with points in L. This is continuous by the way that we draw line segments on L prime and on L, according to the Euclidean notion of continuity, I guess we should say. So this diagram is establishing a continuous map. Now, if you're a fan of epsilon delta definition of continuity, or the limit definition of continuity, or the topological one, it might be interesting to see our intuitive geometric continuity in fact works for this. And I guess it's pretty obvious that any definition of continuity is going to establish F prime in the same way. Now, most people who are purists don't want to hear about somebody saying it's obvious. So we'll just leave this as a homework problem. Verify that the topological definition of continuity generates F prime as a continuous map from L prime to R. Okay, what if you were a bad draftsman? Real number line down here. So suppose you're drawing a line from here's A and here's B over here. Keep the pen down, but it wanders around. Instead of crying that we have a bumpy line, we're going to say, ah, this is a continuous curve. Call it C prime. I suppose that the geometric notion of continuity carries over to this type of drawing a curve between A and B, plane geometry. So check this out. We have this bumpy line, but we can still draw this perpendicular and identify a point P prime on the curve C with a point P on L, number line, and therefore we have the coordinate XP, an element of R, and the same idea, the same projection map here is working for this bumpy curve. Now, and by the same reasoning, you can establish a continuous mapping between points on this curve and the real numbers. If you're really a bad draftsman and you kind of drew something like this, you got to figure out what do you do if you have multiple intersections. But even that's doable, so there's some subtleties to get that right. But in terms of just drawing a kind of nice, slightly bumpy curve, this stuff carries over just fine, and you have a continuous mapping F prime that maps C prime to the real numbers. Okay, now, what if you instead wanted to parameterize this curve, let's say from A to B, say from minus 1 to 1? Okay, what you can do is a little trick here. Let's do it this way. Let's draw a couple of lines here, the segment of the curve. And what we're going to do, we're going to use the circle. So we know that you can map points on the number line to points on the circle in a one-to-one fashion. Since you have a circle here, if you draw a ray from the center of the circle coming out here, now that's going to intersect the curve C prime at some point P prime. And furthermore, if our circle is drawn this way, and this is the angle alpha of points on the circle, becomes the coordinates of this continuum of geometric points, the circle, the coordinates are the angle. And so the angle variable lies in the range of 0 to 2 pi. So you can parameterize a extended curve, segment of a curve, A to B, by the angle of this circle here, or if you wanted to, by taking the sine of alpha. Using this circle as a continuous geometric entity, we've established a continuous mapping between points between the segment of the curve C prime and the angle alpha on the circle. We've parameterized all the points in this segment by a range of numbers between 0 and 1. So the mapping F prime is taking a segment, call it CAB prime, and mapping it to the interval 0 to 1 over here. And this F prime and its inverse provide a continuous one-to-one mapping between points on C prime and the number 0 to 1. This is sort of an interesting angle. Talk about an angle. This is an interesting way of looking at continuity from a geometric point of view and establishing continuous mappings to the real numbers. And we do not need any epsilon and deltas to do this. We just need the notion of a continuous curve. So is that a rigorous notion or not? Well, it can be made rigorous looking at the topology of such curves with a definition of continuity and between topological spaces. Maybe we'll talk about that in another video. The last thing on the list that I wanted to cover here, how do we establish continuity of real-valued functions using this geometric notion of continuity? In order to do that, you need two instances of the real number line. So here is another real number line like this, not necessarily perpendicular to the first one. This instance of the real number line is L1, and this instance of the real number line over here is L2. Okay. Let's draw a straight line between two points. Here's a point A in the plane, and here's a B in the plane over here. We'll draw a straight line. And by postulate 1, that thing is a continuous line segment. I can certainly draw this perpendicular in from the line L1, and it's going to intersect the segment up here. Why don't I call this point Q up here on the segment AB? Okay. Now, nobody can stop me from drawing another perpendicular from the line L2. Nothing wrong with that. And not only that, they can't stop me from doing that, and they can't stop me from drawing it between the point Q and perpendicular to the line L2. Okay? Why don't we call this P2 on L2? So the point where this perpendicular intersects L2 is P2. Now you know what I'm going to do now. The same construction holds for all the points on AB for each of L1 and L2, and therefore this represents a projection map from points on AB to L1. We'll call that Φ1, and this is clearly invertible, so Φ1 inverse exists. And the same way, here is this projection Φ2 works, and it maps points in on the interval to points in L2, and since both L1 and L2 are real number lines, this P2 has a corresponding x. I'm going to call the elements P2 the corresponding real numbers y. So L2 is going to be real numbers labeled by the variable y, so that's a y2, y of P2. Okay. and here is x. You notice that this point Q on the line segment AB corresponds to two different numbers. The point Q on the line segment corresponds to the number xp1 in L1 and the number yp2 on L2. Now, if we move this point Q around, we end up with a whole collection of y's over here and x's over here. And furthermore, every x on L1 can be mapped to a point P on L1, and using the inverse projection map back up to the point Q on the line segment AB, and then we can use the inverse projection map phi 2 inverse to take this Q over to the point P on L2, and finally the coordinate function to take that point P2 to the coordinate yp2. So what have we done? We've established a mapping, the first instance of the real numbers to this other instance of the real numbers over here. I don't know if we need to have the subscripts. We've established a real valued function of a real variable by means of these projection maps and the two instances of the real number line. Further, because of the Euclidean notion of continuity, this f, constructed this way, is a continuous function on this interval, on this line segment AB. Notice that this fails if Q wanders off into space over here on either end of the line segment. So this function is really going to only be defined on a subset of R corresponding to the segment AB. So I would claim that we've established F as a continuous function. It's a continuous linear mapping between sets of real numbers. And that's pretty good. That's a pretty good thing. Obviously, do all kinds of things with this picture, like you can make the same idea with a curve and get a different function. But it looks to me like they have to be continuous and are continuous in the Euclidean sense. Okay, the unification of the Euclidean concept of continuity and the analytic concept of continuity of real valued functions. Pretty sure about this. Everything we've done here with points and lines has a perfectly good analog in functions of real numbers, and I think the continuity using the standard definitions works out just fine for these type of functions. And we'll talk about that later. In a way, what we're trying to do here is build up understanding of continuous functions and the topological notion of continuous mappings between topological spaces. And I think that's really the most elegant, rigorous formulation of continuity. I think it's conceptually easier to understand than the limit and epsilon delta definitions. Of course, they're all three are equivalent, and I believe they're also equivalent to this Euclidean definition of continuity. So we're doing a little bit of conceptual exploring today. I hope you enjoyed this chat, and please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.